Welcome, everyone, to Commonwealth Stadium in Lexington, and welcome to ESPN's College Football Primetime. It's the SEC on ESPN tonight. Number one, the Alabama Crimson Tide taking on the Kentucky Wildcats. Alabama with a 16-game road winning streak intact, and a 9-game winning streak going back to last year on the line as well. Here's a look at the standings and the polls, the AP poll. Remember, the BCS standings come out a week from tomorrow. Alabama checking in at 1, Oregon at 2, and Clemson battling Boston College today. Hello, everybody. I'm Mark Jones, chopping it up alongside Brock Heward, Lewis Johnson down in the sidelines, joining us in just a few moments. Hey, Alabama comes in number one, undefeated 5-0. They have the winning streak going on the road, 16 games. Now, their defense hasn't given up a touchdown in 3 games. Their quarterback is the winningest quarterback in school history. Nick Saban, their head coach, Brock, says, we're still not dominant. What does he mean by that?
Well, it's not just talk. That's where the standard is in Tuscaloosa. That bar is set that high, and they were so good and have been so dominant, Mark. And to me, he was really referring to the line of scrimmage, where there is some work to be done.
When you talk about the line of scrimmage and winning that, ultimately, what does it look like to the plain eye, and what should it look like?
A season ago, I think Alabama had one of the best college offensive lines we have seen. And time and again, they would get to the second level. You will hear me talking about it this evening. Getting a hat on a hat and allowing your stars and your playmakers to get to the perimeter. At times this year, they've done it, but it's been wildly inconsistent. And watch Colorado State. This wasn't a one-time play. 22 carries, 66 yards. The amount of penetration, not letting these backs get started, not getting to the second level. A chance tonight for Alabama to get healthy and get better, and they're going to have to here down the stretch.
That Colorado State game, a little bit of a tipping point. It forced some of the leaders on that defense and the entire team to step up and push this squad in the right direction. Meanwhile, the Kentucky Wildcats trying to snap a 4-game losing streak against these Alabama Crimson Tide players, and Kentucky looking for its first conference win. 0-2, revved up and ready to take on number one.
ESPN College Football Primetime, brought to you by Residence Inn. It's not a room, it's a residence. Timberland, the quality and heritage you trust with new styles crafted for today. And Coke Zero, reminding you to enjoy everything this football season.
And a look at Za'Darius Smith leading the catwalk with an almost religious type zeal. Heading into the stadium, getting ready to take on the number one team in the country, the Alabama Crimson Tide. Kentucky looking for its first conference win of the season. Mark Jones back again with Brock Heward, Lewis Johnson down at the field. Kentucky 2-10 a season ago. Mark Stoops comes in as the head coach, takes the job 10 months ago, and he starts to rebuild things. He's fond of saying we have to follow, quote-unquote, the process. They had 2 starting quarterbacks. Now they're down to 1. Where do they go from here?
Well, I think that's because Mark and his offensive staff have learned that they are incredibly young and inconsistent, and they need playmaking from the quarterback position. That's why you're going to see Jalen Whitlow a whole lot tonight. He took every snap a week ago against South Carolina and played his best game. And think about Alabama. If you're going to somehow craft the miraculous tonight, they have struggled against quarterbacks that can create. And this kid is a dual threat. He can run it. He can throw it. And, oh, by the way, he's from the state of Alabama as well.
Some special feelings for him. Just 19 years old, Lewis Johnson. Kind of young.
That's exactly right. Very young from the state of Alabama, as Mark just mentioned. I watched him very close during warm-ups, and he looked good. All of his throws were crisp, and he seemed to be in control of himself. As Brock mentioned, he took all the throws this week, and I asked him, you know, how was the week getting prepared? How was the stomach? And he said he feels good and everything is okay. But then flashes that smile on the 19-year-old face that tells me that something is churning deep below. I did have a chance to talk to Mark Stoops a moment ago, and he said he wants to see Jalen execute routine plays, be comfortable, and put the ball in routine spots. And then here's something that's just hard to believe. This young man grew up in Prattville, Alabama, just 91 miles from Tuscaloosa, only 69 miles from Alabama, and I asked him which team he dreamed to be a part of as a kid. He said neither. Go figure. Starting for Kentucky tonight.
That's a little bit odd, Lewis, but we'll see what he plays like today. He has a little bit of experience, started 7 games a season ago. Well, Alabama winning the toss, deciding to receive. So we're going to look at the Crimson Tide offense to start the game, and quarterback A.J. McCarron, that's a dangerous return man. White and Christian Jones back as well.
Tremendous energy in this building tonight. A lot of buzz, a lot of folks talking around town. They know who's arrived here in Lexington, the best team in college football. This crowd's ready to rock and roll.
DeAndre White and Christian Jones back deep. It's going to be Jones taking out of the end zone, 3 yards deep. Couple of nice moves and makes it out to the 20-yard line, where it'll be first down and 10 for quarterback A.J. McCarron. In a nutshell, folks, he has more BCS championship rings than he has losses as a starter. 30-2, simply amazing as the starter at Alabama. As a redshirt freshman, he was part of that championship team. And he has continued to grow as a quarterback throughout the course of his 5 years on campus. Has the highest winning percentage of any Alabama quarterback in the school's history. T.J. Yeldon, the lone back. And it's Yeldon on the carry. Brought down for a gain of about one on the play. As we take a look at our Chick-fil-A impact players.
I just have a sense we're going to see a whole bunch of T.J. Yeldon tonight. This offensive line wants to get going. Nick Saban has preached, as we just talked about, a level of physical dominance. And right in the middle for University of Kentucky, the SEC's active leading tackler with over 250 in his career, Avery Williamson, is the Wildcats' best player, according to the head coach, and he's going to have to play his very best tonight.
Has that left hand all bandaged up. Second down and 9, White in motion. Sets to the left. White underneath, a nice run and a couple of nice moves. First down out to the 38-yard line. DeAndre White, who made that circus catch last week for the touchdown against Georgia State.
And A.J. is just so steady, so good in that play-action pass. That's the staple of everything Alabama does. It's the heavy run, the play-action pass off of it. And I think if there's any position group that's better for Alabama than they were a year ago, it's the wide receivers, especially with White getting healthy.
Karen tipped up and incomplete, harmlessly tipped by Za'Darius Smith. Well, let's go back to last week in that game against Georgia State and that catch by DeAndre White. It was one of the SportsCenter top tens and worthy. And I mean worthy. Brock, that's about as good as it gets, man.
That's how you gain the ultimate trust with your quarterback. That's just simply throw it up and I know you're going to get it. And the body control, the strength in the hands, phenomenal effort.
And the tag to that story is his teammates all say, yeah, we're not surprised. We've seen a lot of that in practice from him. Second and 10. Underneath Yeldon, a receiver out of the backfield. And pushed out of bounds just a little bit short of the first down by Eric Dixon.
The more film you watch, there's been a very common thread with the opponents playing against A.J. and these wide receivers, and that is force the checkdowns. Lots of deep coverage. The safeties protect everything deep and make you earn it underneath with those completions. And if that is your strategy, then you cannot miss that first tackle. You've got to bring these Crimson Tide, be it running backs, tight ends, those checkdowns, you got to bring them down.
Third and one. Wildcats loading up the box. Yeldon on the carry, and he'll get the first down. Pascal making the stop. But T.J. Yeldon, the team's leading rusher. 445 yards on 72 carries, a healthy average of 6.2 per pop coming into the game tonight. A lot bigger than people realize, too, Brock. Good size at 6'2".
You better wrap.
First and 10. Barron incomplete, batted away nicely by Fred Tiller. Close quickly on that pass.
Some excellent job coming right at you there. The vision and the awareness in the zone coverage there. Anytime those eyes are focused back on a quarterback or looking inside, you know it's not man-to-man, flips the hips, knocks down the first down play.
Second down and 10. Vogler in motion. Aaron hands it off to Yeldon. Nice cut back to his right. But a better tackle. And the ball squirts out of bounds. But a good shot by Eric Dixon. Third and long coming up for Alabama. Brock, we've seen them in games this year throwing a little bit earlier on the downs, but a good play here. Now Yeldon was down. Chance for the defense to make a statement here early. Wide open and incomplete, dropped by Kenny Bell. So Kentucky's defense gets off the field.
Good call by Doug Nussmeier, offensive coordinator. I told you all the zone coverage many teams are playing. The linebackers cheat up on those checkdowns, and you can't put it in a better spot. But it's basic fundamentals for Kenny Bell. You saw him take his eyes off, try to see the surroundings, not finish the catch. Third downs have been a bit of a challenge for Alabama. You go back and look at Colorado State, Virginia Tech. Those games were closer than they needed to be. And a big part of it was that third down lack of productivity offensively.
Cody Mandel brought in to punt, averaging almost 47 yards per on the season. Up from 44-3 a season ago, and they had an opportunity to down it inside the five, but won't get there in time. 47-yard punt. It'll come back out to the 20, and we get our first look at Jalen Whitlow, who just happens to hail from Alabama.
Visit WatchESPN.com or download the WatchESPN app to watch ESPN live anytime, anywhere. Brought to you by Vizio.
Well, one of the most iconic figures and legendary coaches in all of college football. There he is in the fedora, Paul Bear Bryant. Some may not know that he actually was the head coach of Kentucky from 46 to 1953 and then had that wonderful run at Alabama, six national titles in the poll era, most of all time. You know, I got one of those plaid hats back at the crib, right? First down and 10. And Whitlow's going to take off. And that's part of the reason why he ultimately wrested the starting job for himself exclusively from Maxwell Smith. Make some plays with his legs, Brock.
Was actually a quarterback and wide receiver on his state champion team out of Prattville his senior year of high school. And you will see quarterback draw, quarterback sneak. You'll see sweep just like that. Try to give Alabama a different target to try to hit.
6-yard gain, second and 4. Whitlow didn't look off his receiver, and it's incomplete. In and out of the hands of DeMarco Robinson. Could have been caught. It sets up a third down and 4. Their receivers gonna have to make some plays today, Brock.
Got to win one-on-ones. And you can do what you want to do to try to scheme and plan. And you're going to see plenty of bubble screens, get the ball out of the quarterback's hands. But ultimately, as Neil Brown, offensive coordinator, said, if we're going to get to the fourth quarter, keep this thing close, we have got to win those one-on-one situations just like that.
Comes with a little heat and batted down, incomplete at the line of scrimmage. Vinny Sinceri there to bat it down at the line of scrimmage. He was a safety coming.
He's the unsung stud on this defense. C.J. Mosley is going to be the consensus All-American, the best player. Sinceri, converted linebacker out of high school. And you see it. I know I'm blocked. You pick it up, and he nearly comes down with that interception. He's already got two. He's taken back to the house. Such a good weapon, his ability to both play in space and then get back to his roots, what he was in high school, that linebacker around the line of scrimmage.
Well, Kentucky, Brock, had the ball for all of 36 seconds. Kristen Jones back to receive this punt at his own 28-yard line. Landon Foster with a high spiral coming down at the 25. Jones with a couple nice moves an 8-yard punt return on a 48-yard punt. And Alabama will be on the field for its second series when we come back.
ESPN College Football Primetime, brought to you by Nissan, premier partner of the Heisman Trophy, and Arby's. Try the new Smokehouse Brisket Sandwich today.
Officially nighttime here in Lexington, Kentucky. The SEC on ESPN, Alabama on the field now, first down and 10. A.J. McCarron at the helm.
This is the guy that I'd like to see get started. Right at the bottom of your screen, Amari Cooper there, number 9. He's been banged up with a toe injury. Just have a sense, tonight's the night where the star may shine.
1,000-yard receiver from a season ago. They're going to run it this time, though. And this is Kenyon Drake, second leading rusher on the team with a 7.1 per carry average. They've got some depth at this position. Powder Springs, Georgia, a 6'1 sophomore. Sets up a second down and 2.
Perfect for your play action pass.
Fowler sets in the backfield. They run the ISO. And it's Drake again with a nice move and a first down for Alabama as we go to Wendy Nix. What's good, Wendy?
What's good is the primetime pulse, Mark. Here's a look at what's going on across our networks. On ESPN, Michigan and Penn State, the Nittany Lions have just kicked a field goal 24-20 late in the third quarter. And on ESPNU, Georgia Tech makes the trip out west to face BYU, the Cougars, with a 7-0 lead over Georgia Tech.
All right, Wendy, under 10 minutes to go, just underway here in the first quarter. 15-yard gain by Drake. There's the play action. Plenty of time for McCarron, but nobody to throw to. And he wisely throws it out of bounds. Nobody home. Good coverage in the secondary, it looked like.
Oh, he's just a game manager, though, Mark. That's all he is, just a game manager.
I really don't like that term.
I don't like that term. Nick Saban was exactly right with us. You know, maybe early in his career, you protected him. Maybe he was a game protector. He never put the ball in his hands. Yeah, you know what a game manager does? Doesn't make mistakes. He wins, he limits interceptions, and then when the play is there, well, he hits them time and again in the big moments.
Second down and 10. Hands it off over the right side. Drake still on his feet. Breaks a tackle and brought down inside the 25. A missed tackle by Avery Williamson cost the Wildcats to the tune of 24 yards.
We showed you in the open Alabama's ability or inability to get onto those linebackers. And here they try a little misdirection. As you see, Williamson's got everything right there for him. He's not getting hammered by the big body. That's just a play you got to make. And when Colorado State held this Alabama team to 66 yards, they did not miss those tackles.
Drake getting the ball again. In for Yeldon and making his carries count, and he fumbles it. Kentucky got it. So the first break of the game in favor of Kentucky.
Well, I give you two. I give you the drop third down pass that would have moved the chains into the red zone. Now you've got a fumble in the red zone. It's exactly what you don't want to do when you come into an opponent's house. It's an excellent job there by Eric Dixon to rip at the ball, but you have got to secure that high and tight.
And Fred Tiller made the recovery. And Kentucky will take over first and 10 from their own 13. Alabama, a team that doesn't turn it over. Rarely does. Well, the last time Kentucky had the football, they held on to it for all of 39 seconds. They Fake the fly sweep and run it straight ahead. Raymond Sanders with nowhere to go, stopped up by C.J. Mosley. That's a name that we'll be saying throughout the course of the night with a lot of frequency.
Yeah, I'll go back to the Virginia Tech game week one, and when Chris Spielman says on a broadcast this is the best coached defensive team that he's watched on tape, I'll side with Chris Spielman. And this middle linebacker makes Spielman proud because the big bodies, they love to use those big guys in front to shield those blockers. You keep him free, he doesn't miss on tackles.
Second and 10, Kentucky empties out the formation. Four receivers out to the right. And a design quarterback run will net them about 4 yards. Still looking at a third down, maybe seven to go.
And when you say a well-coached group and a good look at Kirby Smart, that last play is perfect. It's second and 10. This is a chess match. This is what Nick Saban loves and Kirby Smart. So what do? You stunt. You bring a tackle and stunt, knowing that QB draw is coming. You free up your defensive end. And now you put the young quarterback in a nasty third and seven. Well-coached and well-called on both sides of the ball.
Whitlow under heat and sacked. Back at the 7-yard line, the ball loose. The ball loose, they're gonna say he was ruled down at the 6-yard line, the sack coming from Jerick Williams. And that's Whitlow down on the ground. And he's hurt. That's the Tide's 7th sack this season. And Whitlow writhing in pain. Remember, he's making just his 2nd start since earning the number one job. They had split quarterbacks for the first 4 games of the season. Let's take one more look at how it happened. Looked like his knee or leg might have got twisted underneath him there, Brock, his left one.
And Alabama's not a huge pressure team, but they will bring an extra defender at times, and they do on that third down. You see Williams, unfortunately, twisting Whitlow, and he couldn't get his legs out from underneath him, get twisted underneath him. Maxwell Smith, the backup, he's more of the thrower of the two. He's going to have to get loose.
Mark Stoops watching with concern from the sidelines, and Whitlow unable to put pressure on that left leg. So if he can't go, obviously the equation changes offensively with Maxwell Smith in there at quarterback, should he have to come in.
And he started a couple games this year and, in fact, had the biggest day offensively when they blew out Miami of Ohio for 300 yards passing. So he knows the system. He's comfortable. Unfortunately, with that injury to Whitlow, as you see him carried off the field, there goes all of your quarterback run, most of your creativity. And now it's going to be Smith's arm. It's got to get the job done.
From the end zone, Alabama came after it. And Jones fields it back at the 35. A nice return out to the 47-yard line, a 12-yard punt return on a 58-yard punt. The fans booing because they wanted a flag. But it looked like the Alabama defenders slid right underneath them. Foster got it off in time. Didn't get touched. Zeros on the scoreboard with 7:03 to go in the first quarter. A few moments ago during that Landon Foster punt, the fans voicing their displeasure with the lack of a call on roughing the punter. But as you can clearly see, he wasn't touched. And then the official went over to the sidelines and told Mark Stoops, look at the scoreboard, coach. Missed him, went right underneath. Coach said, cool, it's all good. First and 10 coming back the other way. A.J. McCarron pulling the trigger for Alabama. Yeldon back in the ballgame after Kenyon Drake fumbled on their last possession. Yeldon with a couple of spin moves brought down in midfield as we go to Wendy in the studio.
Mark, thank you. It's official. We have a final for Oregon on the road at Washington. Their toughest test to date. They respond Marcus Mariota to Braylon Addison. And the Ducks win this one 45-24. The Huskies kept it close, but ultimately fall short. Utah, though, beating Stanford late in the first half, 21-14. Michigan, Penn State separated by three.
All right, Wendy, second and seven. Hoagland in motion, now sets to the right. Yeldon again over the right side of that offensive line and brought down at the 40. A nice gain by Yeldon, picking up nine for a first down. Brock, that time they seemed to get that second level that we talked about at the top of the show. Good movement on the right side of that line.
Well, you just have to allow Yeldon to square up those shoulders and get going, because if he does, you're going to see Kentucky miss arm tackles. Everybody in college football does. It's that initial penetration that when you make him or any of these backs stop their feet, well, that's how you stop the run game. Yeah, he gets that momentum, he's difficult to tackle.
First and 10 from the 40. Yeldon with a cutback. Got about four. Let's go downstairs to Lewis.
Well, Mark, absolute frustration for Jalen Whitlow, who just left the field on a cart. I just watched him hobble into the locker room. When he came to the sideline, the trainers were looking at the outside of his left ankle, down low there, the outside of the left ankle. They hit a couple spots with their fingers that raised him up off the bench. And when he got up to go to the cart, he slammed his helmet down, and there were just tears in his eyes. You can just see the frustration. I don't know how he comes back, but we'll wait for more of an official update from Kentucky shortly.
All right, thanks a lot, Lewis. Yeah, bad news. And tough break for Whitley. Second down and six. O.J. Howard sets. Little bootleg action and a nice catch by Howard, wide open. The freshman with a nice move down to the 11-yard line. He's been an emerging weapon for Alabama.
And you could see that from the start. Kentucky was confused or trying to substitute. The one thing Kentucky wanted to do was create some communication issues for Alabama. That's been one of their challenges this year with three new starters up front. So they're trying to shuffle some different groups in, give them four-man fronts, three-man fronts, but that time they confused themselves to the point that they leave the tight end wide open.
Kentucky having a tough time substituting on time and now forced to call a timeout. Or be faced
Kentucky, first
with being
of the half.
Disconcerted on the field. Timeout with 4:35 to go in the first. Back after this. Back under the lights at Commonwealth Stadium. Alabama with the football at the Kentucky 11-yard line after the Wildcat timeout. And they get their personnel that they want on the field, which seemed to be the problem a moment ago. Alabama with 125 total yards so far in the ball game. Kentucky with zero. Yeldon fumbles it, and Kentucky got it again. The Tide's second fumble of the game. Avery Williamson on the recovery.
I mean, that's inexcusable, to be quite honest with you. There's times on fumbles that you'll see vicious hits or contact, get a helmet right on the ball. And those are two fumbles, and both of those are critical errors on the grade sheet for Alabama, both in the red zone. Exactly what you don't do against an inferior opponent right now in rebuild mode. And that's three drives, a drop pass and two fumbles, and you know that's going to draw the ire of the head coach. He may not be showing it quite so much, but his gut is turning, knowing you don't come into any venue in this SEC and fumble and bumble around.
New quarterback in for Kentucky, Maxwell Smith. Injured Whitlow, not in the ball game. Smith completes his first pass for the first down at the 12-yard line to Alexander Montgomery. So he comes out slinging and firing on his first play. Remember, as a freshman, he was on the all-freshman, all-SEC team. That's their first down of the ball game. Maxwell started some games last year as well as this year. He hands it off. And a gaping hole up the middle. Raymond Sanders with a 9-yard gain for the Wildcats. And they got a little bit of a spark here because of the turnovers. And there's the Crimson Tide's record when winning the turnover battle so far tonight, down two. JoJo Kemp gets the first down for the Wildcats. A little bit of a buzz here in the stadium now here, partner. Smith taking the snap from his left-handed center, John Tove. Up the middle again, Raymond Sanders. Brought down by Sinceri, picks up four on the play. Sanders led the team in rushing a season ago. And Kentucky, like so many teams this year, going fast. And fumbling. And Sanders lucky there to pick it up.
Yeah, it's going to be a legal motion. You're going to see this tonight with Kentucky. They're very much a work in progress on both sides of the ball, not even getting set.
False start, number one on the offense. 5-yard penalty, second down.
And both Mark Stoops, Neil Brown, they know what the picture is supposed to look like. And Mark knows defensively, as you can see, the quarterback's not even ready for the snap. He knows defensively he doesn't have all the packages in that he wants. It's a fine line, knowing he can't just line up and play vanilla against Alabama. And same with Neil Brown offensively. He has a level of frustration because he knows what the picture will eventually look like. But right now, just trying to get the basic fundamentals down.
Second and 12. Smith just got it off in time and completes it out of the 27-yard line to Anthony Kendrick, the backup tight end, picking up three on the play. So third down and about eight to go. So they're going to have to junk this game up a little bit some tricks, yes, and some mirrors and smoke bombs.
A little bit, but understand here that Maxwell, I'm just watching walk through yesterday. He took plenty of reps. He's taken lots of snaps. This isn't a situation where, for Neil Brown, you've got a backup that's never been in the fire before. He has. He's just more the thrower. You're going to have to live by the pass a bunch more tonight.
Third and nine. Has time. And incomplete. Little man coverage, incomplete, intended for Blue. Javis Blue, the team's leading receiver, couldn't find the handle. And Deion Blue on the coverage for the Crimson Tide.
That's twice now with Deion Blue. He's the best cover corner for Alabama. Some moving parts in their secondary. Eddie Jackson not starting tonight. You're seeing Bradley Silve on the other side, but that's twice with Blue. One-on-one press man coverage, two throw behinds. And Blue gets the Crimson Tide off the field on both occasions.
Brandon Foster in the punt again, his third one of the night. Boy, gets off another good one. Jones won't have a chance to return this one, and good directional punting there. Out of bounds at the 26. Well, get your NFL Sunday started on ESPN at 10. NFL Countdown as host Chris Berman and the gang providing all the latest news and updates from stadiums around the league right up to kickoff. And then, before you set your lineups, catch Fantasy Football Now at 11 a.m. on ESPN2, our expert providing latest news, injury reports, and predict the top fantasy performers. And the question that lingers out there, is Gronkowski going to play? It's like, I'm sure all your callers to your radio show always ask, right, every week? Maybe not so much a concern out on the West Coast in Seattle.
Yeah, they're a little more concerned with the Seahawks getting right than they are with the Gronk. Alabama concerned about their guys getting right. Too many miscues here in the first quarter.
McCarron, dangerously incomplete, intended for Jones. Been a night of mistakes and miscues and miscalculations for the Crimson Tide. A drop pass there by Kenny Bell. The first fumble of the game by Drake. And then Yeldon on the last sequence coughed it up again. So Lou Saban wasn't just, Nick Saban wasn't just, bumping his gums when he told us that we're not dominant yet. So far, anyway. McCarron hands it off to Yeldon. And a nice stick short of the 30-yard line. Rumpf was there to lead the way. And it's third down coming up on the gain of four.
Yeah, the big fella's filling it up. Rumpf, the 300-pounder in the middle, getting down the line. And his compadres flying to the football. That's what Mark Stoops teaches. It's what he's always done every stop he's been. But a tremendous defensive coordinator because he gets helmets to the football. And this stadium, they're feeling some of those miscues by Alabama. Told you coming in, it was cranked up and ready to go. You're going to hear him on third down.
And a flag. He may have another substitution issue.
Substitution on the defense. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
You know, and usually you will see this, and Mark Stoops, he was fired up after the last one. He is just beside himself right now. Usually you'll see this against teams that are no huddle, that are tempo kind of offenses.
Alabama's traditional.
They have plenty of time to huddle up, but this is all based on the different groups you're trying to put out there, the different defensive packages that you're trying to run to give your guys an opportunity to not just line up in the same spot for Alabama to hit you.
Gives them a third and one. Yeldon. Boy, it's going to be close. I think he got enough, though, based on the spot. He earned the first down the hard way. Looks like they're going to measure.
And Mark, I know yesterday when Coach Saban walked into our meeting and he starts to talk about them not being dominant, I think it's easy to roll your eyes and say, oh, come on. How many weeks have you been number one? How many championships do you have? But he's used to seeing the group at the point of attack dominate opponents and break their will. And that's been the part of this season that really jumped out to me on film as well, as I asked him to just kind of define the personality of this offensive line. A season ago, you're going to see Warmack and Barrett Jones and Fluker. Kentucky has blown 2 yards back time and again. And it's just a work in progress. He feels like it's not the talent, it's the level of continuity, it's communication, it's trusting one another next to you. But I think there's also some competition with some young guys behind these veterans to really push them to get what Saban wants.
McCarron finds O.J. Howard, makes a nice move to get another first down, just shy of midfield as we go back to Wendy in the studio.
It's a Taco Bell studio update. Georgia Tech on the road at BYU. This game on ESPNU. But check out this catch. Tyson Hill to Cody Hoffman. Just a beautiful catch. Worth another look. Hoffman, 3 catches, 66 yards, 14-7 BYU.
Right, Wendy, back here after the 12-yard pickup. It's first down and 10. Less than half a minute to go in the first quarter. Alabama surprisingly has not scored. McCarron taking a shot deep. Jones incomplete. Broken up nicely by Blake McClain. Well, at some point you thought Alabama would try and pop the top on that defense. But a nice defensive play by McClain. And a flag down.
Personal foul, hands to the face. Number 94 on the defense. 15-yard penalty, first down.
The one element as I watch A.J. McCarron on tape this season that I just love to see a little bit more, and I know the NFL scouts will as well, on these deep passes, just don't make your guys slow down. It's the right read. It's an accurate throw. It's not vastly overthrown. But those are the throws that you got to just find a way to hit. And the obvious penalty there by Za'Darius Smith, hands to the face of Quanjo.
Then he had his brother, Cyrus Quanjo, come in and have his back a little bit. But still, first down, 18 seconds to go. And tough sledding so far, surprisingly. The number one Alabama Crimson Tide, Yeldon, who's fumbled once in this game, lunging forward to the 30-yard line. Got 6 yards, and that'll probably punctuate the end of the first 15 minutes of play here under the lights at Commonwealth Stadium. Number one, Alabama, 0, Kentucky, 0. The Big Blue Nation will take it back on the other side. Welcome back, everyone, to Lexington. Under the lights at Commonwealth Stadium, there's a buzz, and you're watching the SEC on ESPN. Number one, Alabama, in a little bit of a fight here against Kentucky, trying to snap a 4-game losing streak against the Crimson Tide. I'm Mark Jones alongside Brock Heward. Lewis Johnson down to the field. Second down and four as we start the second quarter. Play action. Yeldon wide open. And incomplete. He dropped it. And it certainly, possibly, could have been a touchdown.
How many times have you seen this in the first 15 minutes and 10 seconds? How many times have you seen this? Critical drops, fumbles in the red zone. I haven't seen this game before out of the first quarter. Usually this is a team in the Roll Tide Nation hands in despair. They know it, that you've not been, this has not been all Kentucky forcing you into mistakes. These are self-induced, uncharacteristic to say the least.
Third and four. McCarron complete. White hanging on. Brought down at the 24 and picks up enough for the first down. Yeah, Nick Saban and Doug Nussmeier, the offensive coordinator, have to be shaking their heads at what they've seen transpire in the first quarter. We have an injured player down in the field. That's Ashley Lowry. Kentucky has already lost its starting quarterback. Maybe not for the night. We'll get an update from Lewis Johnson as our quarterback Jalen Whitlow was hurt on the second series of the ball game. We'll be back in a minute. Welcome back, and you're looking at Ashley Lowry, the starting strong safety for Kentucky, being tended to on the sidelines. Here's what happened a moment ago. Watch what happens, Brock, late on this play. Ari Quanjo comes in, number 77, and that looks like a penalty to me.
You can play to and through the whistle, but you cannot lead with the crown of your helmet into the small of someone's back around the pile. I'm shocked that that did not draw a 15-yard penalty.
First and 10 from the 24. Karen hits his receiver. Amari Cooper made a nice spin move. His forward progress is going to give him enough for the first down. And Brock, that's the guy you're looking to break out tonight. His helmet comes off, so it's like he might have to come out. He does.
Well, he's the guy they're going to need down the road against an LSU and against some of the elite competition. You're going to need Cooper to be the difference maker he was a year ago. Nice to see Lowry back in the game. But Cooper has had an injury, a toe injury this year. Just been hobbled, not quite right. Nick Saban telling us yesterday he's getting closer than ever. And this isn't just for this evening, but as you build throughout the rest of this season, and you know you're going to need to win one-on-one situations, he's still their most dynamic athlete on the outside.
You talk about LSU. They get LSU at home, and boy, what a performance by LSU in holding Florida to just well below their season average offensively this year.
You don't set every freshman record there, yards, touchdowns, a season ago as Cooper did, unless you're immensely gifted in this program, and he is.
Out of Miami Northwestern High School. Talented football hotbed down in South Florida. First and 10. Yeldon stops on a dime. Made a nice move and brought down by Eric Dixon. Picked up four on the play.
So you've had a drop pass and two fumbles right around the red zone. You think you're going to just see the hammer? You think you're just going to see run after run after run and establish that line of scrimmage?
Hand it off again to Yeldon. Yeldon has stopped up after a gain of about two. Brock, Alabama going quick now offensively. What's the thought process behind that?
Let's get yourself out of some of this funk that you're in and stop thinking about those mistakes that you've made. You know, you go react, you play fast. You're trying to keep those defensive packages off the field for Kentucky. And just try to get yourself, kickstart yourself into rhythm.
Third and three. And
wouldn't this be huge if Kentucky can hold Bama to just a field goal here?
Alabama's fumbled twice in the red zone. McCarron under some heat. And he throws it away. That's a win for Kentucky on defense. Fourth and three, and in comes the field goal unit.
Yeah, Mark Stoops knows how to coach defense. And A.J. had nowhere to go with the football. Pretty good protection. Yeldon stepped up into the gap, picked up the blitzer, but nowhere to throw it for. Well, we'll say it again. He's just a game manager, Mark. He just throws the ball away to live to play another day.
30-2 as a starter. Must be doing something right. Kate Foster in to try this field goal from 25 yards out. 5 of 6 on the season. And we have our first points of the ball game coming from Alabama, courtesy of Foster. Back with more after this.
ESPN College Football Primetime, brought to you by Pennzoil. We know it doesn't matter what you do in your car, it only matters what you put in it.
And back live in Lexington with the score, Alabama 3, Kentucky nothing. And let's take a look at the FaceTime profile brought to you by Edward Jones. Well, this past May, 3 Kentucky seniors traveled to Ethiopia, part of an athletic department service trip. Jonathan George, Kevin Mitchell, Avery Williamson.
Yeah, the great magnanimous gesture by the Kentucky football players in their trip across the seas to do some good work on behalf of the school. And Lewis will tell us a little bit more on that a little bit later.
Well, the stat line doesn't show it, but they're getting some good work in. 181-30, they've been outgained, but you force a couple turnovers. You force the field goal there, just 3 points. And that's, you said it earlier, that's a win for Kentucky. You'd be sitting here into the second quarter down just 3. That's another win.
Let's see what Maxwell Smith can get done here on his second series. If you're just joining us, Jalen Whitlow, starting quarterback for Kentucky, knocked out of the game on the game's second series, suffering a leg injury. Lewis Johnson getting us an update in a bit on that. He's still in the locker room being tended to. Maxwell Smith in the ball game now. They had a 2-quarterback rotation up until the previous game last week against South Carolina, a game in which Whitlow started and went the distance, actually had 3 touchdowns in that near miss comeback and that loss to South Carolina. Maxwell Smith in now as a sophomore, started in 4 games that he played, completed almost 69% of his passes. Here he is on play action, completes it to Ryan Timmons. And Timmons, one of those young receivers that they have trying to build on.
Alabama is going to make you earn every single yard. And I know A&M had a field day, but you look at the other 4 games, they have been so sound. They don't make mistakes. They don't drop coverage. They don't give you anything. You have got to earn every completion, every hard yard. Even that completion gets you 0.
It hands it off, and a nice gain up the middle. Raymond Sanders with a first down run. A little breathing room out to the 37. We got one of the linemen, Kevin Mitchell, looked like he blew a tire. 12-yard gain on that last play. And off again to Sanders, and nowhere to go that time as we go back to Wendy in the studio.
Mark, thank you very much. We check on Michigan, Penn State, a 3-point ball game here when Devin Gardner finds Devin Funchess, his second touchdown reception of the game. It's now 34-27 on ESPN.
All right, Wendy, a loss of 1 on that last play. This Alabama defense hasn't given up a touchdown in 3 games. That's one side of the story. The other side of the story is 42 points they gave up against Texas A&M. Almost intercepted in and out of the hands of Vinicius Seri, who's already has 2 pick-sixes this year, and he comes up limping.
Coach's son, he is so savvy. And Smith better be very, very careful staring down those routes between the hashes. Sinceri all over that. And you're right, that looked very eerily similar to the Virginia Tech, Texas A&M pick sixes he had just a half step away.
One of the real leaders back there in that defensive backfield. Kentucky is yet to convert on third down tonight. They're 0 for 3. I hear a little motion up front.
False start, 70. Offense, 5-yard penalty, third down.
Kentucky looks a little disjointed tonight, Brock. Not only, well, on both sides of the ball in terms of getting personnel in and out of the game, and it's not all on the same page, it looks like.
Yeah, quality opponents can do that to you. A little different voice now under center or in the shotgun for Kentucky. This is what Neil Brown said. If they can get drives started, they've had some success. But if they don't get those first downs or they get a negative play, awfully hard to get in a rhythm for them.
Smith hands it off, and this is Raymond Sanders again. Sanders got about 5 on the play. We haven't seen that much of JoJo Kemp tonight, who's the other half of that tailback tandem. Fourth down coming up, and the Wildcats will have to punt. They have yet to convert on third down.
The other thing you see, Mark, and which just plays itself out, is so many of these up-tempo teams, it's about box count. It's about the numbers game. And by look, Alabama says to you, run the ball, but they're so stout and they are so strong within there, and their linebackers scrape and tackle so well that they just really mess with your numbers game, and you're seeing that here through the first quarter and a half.
Low snap, but Foster gets off a high punt. Jones takes it on the run. Boy, that's a pretty brazen move. Looking for a couple of blockers, got one or two. And Jones with a nice punt return into Kentucky territory at the 43-yard line. He's already taken one back for a touchdown this year. Had one against Virginia Tech. Christian Jones, lethal and potent in the punt return game. Has a punt return for a touchdown. Also has a kick return for a touchdown this year. And to show you that he's like that Swiss Army knife, he can catch for touchdowns too.
Yeah, all in one game, and they needed him that first game out against Virginia Tech. That group with the Hokies, and they've shown it this season. That's their only loss. They played good defense. Jones was the X factor in the special teams game. Let's see if that return could ignite this offense and this whole team just a little bit.
Play action. Taking a shot down deep. At the 1-yard line, what a grab by Kevin Norwood. 42 yards to the 1-yard line.
Not exactly how you draw it up. Kentucky keeps the deep safety in the middle third, but AJ says enough's enough. I trust my athletes more than your athletes, and I'm just going to give Norwood an opportunity, a jump ball there, and he shows you he can go just a little bit higher than Lowry and Willie, double coverage.
First and goal from the 1.
Wow.
Drake, touchdown Alabama. Their first one of the game. Set up by that great catch by Kevin Norwood right there.
It's always remarkable what a little momentum will do for you. And you get the momentum of the punt return. You had to think that Nussmeier would take his shot and maybe even told his quarterback, hey, you know what? Enough's enough. Okay, let's stop playing this thing quite so conservatively. We're better than Kentucky is on the back end of that. Trust your receiver to go make a play. They do. And then this time they don't fumble. They punch it in.
The extra point good, and Alabama leads it 10-0. That time they don't implode in the red zone. McCarron with the handoff, and Drake getting the deal done. Andrew Luck and the Colts look to stay on the winning track as they head out west to face Philip Rivers and the Chargers, who try to get back to 500. Coverage beginning with Monday Night Countdown at 6:30. Then Indianapolis, San Diego, Monday at 8:25 on ESPN. Also live on Watch ESPN. Hey, what about Andrew Luck and what he did to that Seattle team last week? Yeah, a little surprise?
Not many people do that against that secondary. I actually was asking Pete Carroll on Monday after that game, and Pete agreed with me. I've never seen Andrew play as well as he is right now. He was obviously tremendous collegiately, the number one pick, Tom McShay's highest guy he ever graded, right there with a Peyton Manning, and he's only gotten better here very early in his professional career.
From the goal line, Blue out to the 23-yard line. Speaking of Luck, Stanford down right now, trailing right now in their game. And Oregon getting a win today in the Pac-12. Tough win against Washington in Seattle.
Well, tough is exactly what Alabama has been offensively in this second quarter this season, defensively for that matter as well. Just a field goal given up in this second frame, and that's in five outings.
If you're Kentucky, what do you do here without panicking?
Oh, you can. Yes. What you've got to do is find some easy completions in here. And Neil Brown, offensive coordinator, was exactly right. He said Alabama just doesn't give you some of those easy completions that everybody else does. And you've got to find a way to move the chains here and start to establish some of your tempo.
Play fake. Incomplete. And a flag thrown on the play. Robinson, the intended receiver.
Pass interference, 16 defense, penalty, placed at the spot where the foul occurred. First down.
It's against Silva.
And I think he's the guy you also formationally got to try to attack. Players, formations, plays. You've tested Blue on a couple occasions, and it's come out the wrong way. Silva, the redshirt sophomore, he's been the other side, the moving part with Jackson, Fulton.
All eyes on the Crimson Tide, ranked number one in the country. Incomplete at the 39-yard line. And, you know, when you're number one, you seem to trend worldwide as hashtag Bama versus UK is right now, worldwide on social media.
I think that's what happens when it's a 0-0 in the first 15 minutes. Some people wondering just what is Kentucky getting done? Well, offensively, all they've gotten done is punt, 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 which is nothing. And Alabama's dominated this game statistically, but the great equalizer, those takeaways, Kentucky's got a couple of those. Now they're hanging around.
But the Wildcats just 46 yards of total offense, adding to the total here. Remember, this what happened earlier to Jalen Whitlow, the starting quarterback, injured on the second series of the ball game and has not returned since. Lewis Johnson reporting he was taken into the locker room, visibly upset, tears coming down his cheeks, and Maxwell Smith taking over. Corey Herrick making that last catch, third and three coming up. Boy, Howie got that pass off to Sanders. I'm not sure, it's out of bounds. But that pass came out of a pack of white jerseys. Almost looked like Smith was swallowed up back there. And not even close. And another three now.
And those are the plays. I mean, you see Alabama and McCarron throw it into double coverage, and Norwood comes down with the big bomb. That time, you protect well enough to at least give yourself a chance. And you see an open Sanders actually has Mosley beaten. He just can't execute in your one-on-ones.
Christian Jones watches it bounce at the 20. Alabama players getting out of the way. And a good punt by Landon Foster, who's been busy tonight. That was his fifth of the evening, a 47-yard effort. A.J. McCarron, game manager, star quality. We'll talk about that when we come back. Under the lights at Commonwealth Stadium, where Alabama is 14-2 all time. here in Lexington. Kentucky's had opportunities here in the first half. A couple of Alabama turnovers, two fumbles, and unable to convert them into points. Drake in the backfield, two tight ends, two wide receivers in. Drake found a hole over that right side and good push out near the first down, Brock.
Take a look at that picture compared to early in this game. That is what you're looking at. That's physically dominating your opponent. That's blowing them off the ball. And be it Yeldon, be it Drake, you're not even seeing the young puppies as well. You get them ahead of steam. I mean, you see how hard it is for Kentucky to gain a yard. When you just get that movement at the point of attack, that tide, well, quite literally starts rolling. You get big chunks in the run game like that.
Nick Saban says that in the last couple of games, they've improved their consistency of performance. And it's trending in the right direction. He pointed to the line of scrimmage in particular in terms of that improvement. Quandro brothers, Chad Lindsay, Alan Anthony Steen, and Austin Shepard. Grant Hill also getting an opportunity at left, pardon me, right tackle. You're going to measure here for the first down. Alabama's been pretty balanced in the way they've done things here tonight, Brock. Going back to last year, they're a picture of balance as well.
Well, if you're going to be a pro-style system, you're going to have that level of balance. Yeah, a year ago, how about 3,100 rushing yards, 3,052 passing yards? I mean, that's almost silly in the level of balance.
First and 10. Karen steps up and falls forward to the 24-yard line. Za'Darius Smith making the tackle for Kentucky, a 2-yard gain on the play. But to McCarron's credit, the theory is that he's resisted the temptation to force deep balls and just take what the defense is giving him. You're laughing. Well, give me more after this play, second and 8. Part of that game manager tag that can be a little bit of a curse in the way it's perceived. Hands it off to Drake, and Drake got about 4 on the play. But what about the fact that it's a little dink and dunk, and once in a while he'll take the shot, but not the big explosive plays?
I just don't see that. That just doesn't show up over the last couple years. Now, you want to look at his first 12 starts of his career? Sure. They really protected him. And I love the story in the conversation with Nick Saban yesterday, walking us back to the beginning of his career, when it was, hey, you're not going to beat LSU in the championship unless, AJ, we trust you. And I'm telling you, we're going to trust you. The game's in your hands. And really, from that moment forward, you don't see a system, you don't see play calls that don't trust their quarterback.
Fifth year senior looking at 3rd and 4. Out of the backfield to Drake, complete. Efficiency, there it is, first down.
And I think most people, Mark, will associate a game manager as, wow, we got to manage it from the play calling situation. We got to manage it from the other phases of the game. We got to manage it because we don't really believe he can win the game for us if asked. And he's proven it. 30-2, the highest winning percentage, not just for the Crimson Tide. That's the highest percentage in the history of this conference at 30-2. Not in total wins, but winning percentage. And you can't get that done no matter how good the supporting cast is if the people calling the shots don't trust and believe in your talents.
First and 10. That all day comes underneath, and it's dropped by Drake. When asked about that game manager tag that McCarron has been tagged with, he says, you know what, hey, I don't care as long as we keep winning. You know, and he is evolved and come a long way from the time he was a true freshman and they made him scrimmage with the third team scout team, and he was frustrated. Bad body language came into Coach Saban's office afterwards, and Coach Saban said, you know what, you didn't exactly pass that leadership test, but he understood the point that was being made and has grown exponentially since that time. McCarron taking off. out to the 45-yard line, about 3 yards short of the first down, picked up six. Pretty impressive numbers. The winning percentage, number one all time in the SEC and at Alabama. 59 touchdown passes. Everyone he throws is a new record.
Well, as you said, as he worked his way in his redshirt year, he was the backup by the end of the season. Won a ring there when McElroy was the starting quarterback. He's got three rings. They continue on this pace and this path. Who else can say I can walk away from my collegiate career with four championship rings and me holding three of them as a starter? It's unheard of stuff.
Third and three. Pass complete. Good enough for a first down on Kentucky's side of midfield. Kevin Norwood went low to hang on to it, picks up six.
And back-to-back third down conversions. And once again, when you're going to play this style, you're not up-tempo, and in this SEC world, in the landscape, it's almost the haves and the have-nots. Either we're going to have it, and we're going to spread it, and we're going to go up-tempo, or we're not going to do it, Florida, LSU, Alabama. And if you're going to play this style, then finding completions on third downs, moving the sticks, is what he's done for 4 years.
It off to Drake going into the boundary, and a good stick right there at the 48-yard line. Number 26, Eric Dixon, bringing the heat and the wood. He's got a play that can get this defense ignited. And we have an official that's down. Looks like he may have gotten tangled up in that last play. Yeah, the official got tangled up. Jeff Batts, the field judge, being looked at by the Kentucky staff. Hey. 5:08 to go.
Backup ready for action.
Yeah. We're going to take a timeout and sort it out when we come back. Well, you're looking at Terry Walters, the line judge, being tended to by the UK athletic staff and medical staff, shaken up a moment ago. But right now, Alabama leading 10-0. Brock, what's the first thing when you look at the storyline of the game, the way it's developed and emerged so far, that jumps off the page at you?
Well, it's going to be the miscues of Alabama in the first quarter and then cleaning it up. The big punt return, the shot that McCarron took, even into double coverage. And the defense doing what you would expect one of the elite defenses in this game to do, and that's completely shut down Kentucky with all five possessions, five punts, and just a few first downs all evening long.
Drake in the backfield on second down and eight. Underneath, complete to Jones. And Jones inside the 40, enough for the first down. Christian Jones, such a weapon in so many different ways for this Alabama team out of Adamsville, Alabama. First down and 10. And the player on the field is Nate Willis. Backup defensive back. Out of Pahokee, Florida. You know, you look at where some of the players are from Kentucky. Mark Stoops, all his years at Florida State, has some great connections in Central Florida, Northern Florida, and South Florida in particular. And you look at the recruiting now that they've been able to establish. Things are really on the rise at UK when you project forward a little bit, Brock.
Well, he put together the highest ranked recruiting class, and they've not kept those for decades and decades. But a season ago, when hired at the end of November, put together a group. The many considered inside the top 30. The right now has got a group just outside the top 15. And he has no grand illusions. He knows the work ahead of him, not only with the current kids in the program to get bigger and faster and stronger, but to recruit those difference makers, recruit some of the talent, some of the athletes, so you can go toe-to-toe a little bit more in this conference.
He doesn't have to look far to look for a good blueprint to follow. You know, a lot of his philosophies align with, as you look at the recruiting ranks, one player in the 150, in the 35, in the 300, and the 6 four-star recruits. But Stoops, Brock, worked with Jimbo Fisher, who worked a long time at LSU with Nick Saban.
Yeah, and they know that it's not just the X's and O's. The lifeblood is your recruiting. When was the last time that you could see a Kentucky football class, not basketball class, but football class, ranked anywhere in the top 20, let alone number 16 as it sits right now?
That's Jones on the sweep. Well, they use him in so many different ways. A nice run inside the 25 by Christian Jones. You know, I thought I'd be the first one to bring up Kentucky basketball tonight. You beat me to it. 14-yard gain by Christian Jones and another first down for the Crimson Tide.
And these are the kind of drives, and you could get the sense here when Alabama got the ball back after another good punt. Fans on their feet, they knew, they sensed that, boy, this defense has got to find a way to get off the field. They've been on the field this entire first half. And what does Alabama do? And what they've done so many times, start to put their foot right on the throat, a methodical drive, marching right down the field.
That's out of the offset eye, play action. Nice pass by McCarron, right on the money to Amari Cooper. And they're going to say he's out of bounds. Everyone quite aware of where he should have been. Boy, that, well, his heel was on the line when he came down. Second and 10. Amari Cooper, about 59 passes for 1,000 yards a season ago. Yeldon in the backfield, single back set. Yeldon with a nice move. Nimble feet. Yeldon, touchdown Alabama. It can happen that quick with the volatility.
You talk about the nimble feet, Mark. Here's the difference. Look at where the nimble feet occur. They occur 7 yards downfield. Not in the backfield, not stopped up, not the initial penetration. Tremendous push, a hat on a hat. And then you allow these big backs to make that one cut. And it's lights out.
Six in the SEC in rushing coming into the game tonight. Alabama's lead now up to 17-0 on his fifth rushing touchdown this season. Alabama's lead 17-0. Looking for their sixth consecutive win of the season. Yeldon with the touchdown run a moment ago. And when you look at Alabama, the abundance of talent they have, Brock, you know, when you have a guy that struggles like Drake did with the fumble, and then Yeldon comes in and Yeldon fumbles it, there's always a number three or even number four guy that you can go to if you're Nick Saban. This one will come out to the 25, and we go back to Wendy in the studio.
Mark, thank you. Penn State trailing Michigan, 34-27. Look at the clock, 35 seconds. This team travels 80 yards in 33 seconds. An absolutely fantastic catch by Allen Robinson down at the one. And then Christian Hackenberg here takes it in himself. The play would be reviewed. The touchdown stands. Michigan misses a last-second field goal. We're tied and going to overtime.
Been an eye-opening day so far. Look at the Texas surprise against Oklahoma. Missouri upsetting Georgia in Athens. And Georgia shorthanded. Missouri did a great job nonetheless, not to discount their performance. That's JoJo Kemp, a talented true freshman out of DeLand, Florida. Well, Kentucky faced with a conundrum now. They can't let it slip away too far. And the second leading rusher on the team coming into tonight. Did a nice job last week in that near miss, that loss against South Carolina. Here he is again. One of the young talented players that Coach Stoops is hoping to build his program on. Well, with in-depth analysis, discussion of the standings, potential impact of upcoming games, and interviews with college football coaches and players, you won't want to go anywhere else. BCS Countdown presented by Allstate next Sunday at 8:30 on ESPN, then at 9 on ESPNU. Both shows also live on Watch ESPN. Partner, it's about that time. Get those standings coming out. And when you talk about standings, you talk about style points. Who's got them? Who doesn't? What do the polls think? What do the computers think? Pass incomplete, and they can ill afford to have Timmons and others dropping passes like that. Here's a look at the projected BCS standings by Brad Edwards. Brought to you by Allstate. Revealed next Sunday at 8:30. Stanford losing right now against Utah.
A lot of conversation about the Pac-12 and the strength of the conference. And one of the real compliments is there's very few easy games. Cal is in rebuild mode. But you had a sense Stanford came out of that Washington game really beat up and going and playing a very physical front seven of Utah. And right now, what a win that would be for Kyle Whittingham as they too.
You're being modest, partner. You called that one today. That was your upset special. Sixth punt. Taken on the run by Jones. Actually, a 41-yard punt. And Christian Jones with a return with 2:11 to go here and an opportunity for Nick Saban. Nick Saban,
a little smile.
A little smile. Whoa. Yeah, interesting yesterday. In our meetings with Coach Saban, it seemed to, albeit a little bit, maybe disappointed. And
the receiver gave a signal when he gained possession, the ball is dead at that spot.
So it'll come back to the 30-yard line. Seemed a little bit, slightly disappointed in their performance, but understandably when he talked about his room for improvement, the team's room for improvement, but very much a coach at ease.
You have been around the best coaches, Mark, and I don't care what sport it is. It's all about process. It's all about constantly moving ahead, not focusing on anything in the rearview mirror. An ugly first quarter, not kind of the progress or the process he wanted, but a much better second here.
Drake with the handoff. That offensive line providing a yawning hole for him. Out over the 40 to the 41, an 11-yard pickup on the play. 2 minutes to go here. Alabama with its full complement of three timeouts remaining in the half.
And I'd be willing to contend that that's the most important aspect here over the final 32 minutes of this game is to continue to establish yourself at that point of attack.
McCarron completes the pass. Norwood had a flag down. A couple of them thrown on the field. We could have a face mask on this. 13-yard gain if it stands.
Personal foul. Grabbing the face mask. 15 on the defense. Penalty added on to the end of the run. First down.
Oh, he got it.
Yeah, that's
no doubt about that.
Yeah, no brainer. And the reason, Mark, I said that point of attack and that line of scrimmage, because to me, you know so much what AJ and the rest of the crew can do, what these receivers can do, what your running backs can do. It's that component that's really been playing catch up all season long and put together a really good second quarter here.
Barron underneath to Drake, making a play with his legs, run after catch, and a lot of it down to the seven. We go back to Wendy in the studio.
Mark, thank you so much. Coming up on the Outback Steakhouse Halftime Report, a pair of Pac-12 powerhouses in action. Texas gets a final word over Oklahoma, and Missouri with a big win over Georgia but may have suffered an even bigger loss. We'll have an update with Todd McShay and Robert Smith coming up at the half.
First and goal.
Crowd's got quiet, huh?
Alabama team will do that to you. Right split to the bottom of your screen. O.J. Howard sets. Play action by McCarron. And dropped after being juggled by Jalston Fowler, the fullback out of the backfield. And that smile that was temporarily across Coach Saban's face is gone.
He's got two of these already this season, both touchdown receptions. Very much on that play. He's the big back and such a good blocker. Everything set up. But like we've seen on a few times, be some coaching tape for Nick and his crew on Sunday morning to take a look at just some of the finer fundamentals and details to finish.
Drake empties out the backfield. Second and goal. Two on the play clock. They're going to blow this one dead.
False start. 64 offense. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
Another coaching moment for Coach Saban.
Yeah, and keep an eye on number 64. That's Grant Hill. And you're going to see Nick Saban. He wants the timeout here to gather his troops.
Yeah, Mount Saban is about to pop here a little bit. Well, Brock, the hair on the back of my neck was coming up a little bit watching Coach Saban, but we were talking about earlier, Alabama ranked number one, Oregon and Stanford in hot pursuit. So far, there's a lack of style points on Alabama's part. Your thoughts moving forward now with the, well, a little over a week with the standings coming out.
Well, elite teams do what? They put some negative plays and a negative quarter behind them, and this has been business as usual. This has been the dominant Alabama here in the second quarter. But you alluded to it earlier. Those computer polls are coming out, the human polls, the AP, everything's going to be thrown into the mix next Sunday. And for my money, as we sit today, and there's going to be a big one between Clemson and Florida State right next weekend, but what Oregon did today at Husky Stadium in Seattle in that rivalry, and Marcus Mariota is as good as anybody in the
so
game.
So you think
today
the gap is narrowed between Alabama? You think Oregon has leapfrogged Alabama?
Oh, I would love to see that game. I'd love to see it now. I'd love to see it in January. I would have loved to have seen it last January. Yeah, I think that's the game that many look at. And to me, the defining factor for Oregon, in fact, older brother who works at the University of Washington, does their radio, texted me here about a half hour ago and said there's never been an Oregon quarterback like Marcus Mariota. And that's why he is a legitimate Heisman contender and can match wits even with a fifth-year senior like McCarron.
Second and goal. Hand off to Drake. Nice moves. Gets great push. Brought down just shy of the end zone. They're not going to give him the touchdown. Third and goal coming up.
Timeout. Alabama. Second timeout of the half.
Well, that picture tells you the whole story about one side that gets right now the elite of the elite that develops them as Nick does, a bunch of grown men including 210-pound running back against some safeties and linebackers that just are not physically equipped to take on that kind of force right now.
Yeah, we were talking about and speculating who might be the fastest player on that Alabama team, and you talk about the talent, and we went through a bunch of names and then we thought, oh yeah, what about Kenyon Drake? We forgot about him, and he might be the fastest player.
You know, typically those coaches are a little careful, right? It was Doug Nussmeier, I think, at that point. And we said, hey, who's the fastest guy? And there you see Drake and Yeldon, the yards per carry dominant. I said, oh, that's a good question. I don't know. No, you line them all up at the goal line. Who's your fastest guy to the 40 or 50? And when you don't know and you're bouncing around between Cooper and Norwood and Drake, that's a good problem to have.
That's a lot of guys at a place like Alabama. Third and goal.
Let's see if they run behind that number 64. He got a good chewing from his head coach, and I know Nick likes a true freshman. Let's see if they run right behind the true freshman right tackle.
That's Grant Hill. Up over top, touchdown, and he stuck the landing, too. Kenyon Drake makes it 23-0, Alabama.
young players don't particularly like to be yelled at. And you can see some of the strength there, actually. It's Hill blocking back down. And it's not fun, I'm sure, to get a lashing like that. And when AJ got it back when he was redshirting as a freshman, yeah, you don't always enjoy those. But it should be a pretty good sign to both player and fan base how much he thinks of that guy. And watch Grant Hill through the remainder of this season and see just how much he pushes for that right tackle job.
Saban put Hill on blast a moment ago, and the offense blasted a hole for Drake for this touchdown. Well, folks, the most storied conference in college athletics will live on a new network. Tradition finding a new home. The SEC Network launching August 2014. For more information, log on to www.getsecnetwork.com. Well, Drake, Yeldon, Drake, D. Hart, Derrick Henry. There's a lot of depth at that tailback spot for Alabama. The offensive line, admittedly for them, still a work in progress.
That's pretty good numbers, huh? 54-0, that's pretty good track record, and this is what else I love.
Best players on special teams?
Yeah, and you'll see C.J. Mosley, and you'll see the whole rest of the crew, and especially young guys. Okay, you got the five stars. All right, everyone loves you. Well, come cover kicks. That's how you earn your stripes, how you cut your teeth in this program.
Nick Saban has created a culture at Alabama where entitlement just doesn't exist.
Well, you've seen it here, Mark, and Big Blue is known for its basketball. Calipari is the same way, right? It's not just about throwing all the talent in and go play. It's about cutting that entitlement out and understanding there's got to be a work ethic and commitment to develop all that talent. Calipari's track record's been pretty good. And so has Nick Saban's here at Bama.
Raymond Sanders on the kickoff return. Spins outside and crosses the 20, brought down at about the 22-yard line. You mentioned Calipari, and hey, we're around the time of Midnight Madness, so we're good around these college campuses. What about Jameis Winston? I don't know if you saw the videotape from last night. It was a SportsCenter top 10 play. The quarterback for Florida State throws a half-court alley-oop with a football that one of the Seminole players dunked home.
Does that surprise you?
That is Heisman-esque, you know.
You don't think quarterbacks can play a little hoops?
Don't get your feelings hurt.
I've not known any quarterback that couldn't play hoops.
Don't get your feelings hurt now. First and 10. There's JoJo Kemp. And Kemp gains about 5. They're in hurry-up mode, but they're probably not going to get this playoff. That's the end of the first half of play. Alabama looking for its 17th consecutive win on the road, and their 10th win in a row dating back to last year. 24-0 at the break. Let's go downstairs to Lewis Johnson.
All right, Coach, you said before this game you wanted to continue the process of becoming a dominant team, but you started with a couple of turnovers, drop balls. What was going on early?
Yeah, but we still dominated the game. I mean,
early on.
Well, but we dominated the game. We went right down the field and fumbled the ball. So what's going on is we turned the ball over. The fact that we were dominating the line of scrimmage and moving the ball, we're still moving the ball. So that's what was going on. And the turnovers and drop balls, that's what was going on.
All right, what's the message inside the locker room? Because I'm imagining you're not happy with the way the first half was played.
Well, I'm not happy that we didn't finish the drives. So, you know, I mean, ball security is always important, especially when you're on the road. So we can't turn the ball over, man. We got to do a better job a little bit on defense, but we'll be all right.
All right, thanks.
Thanks.
Hey, Mark.
Nick Saban coaching him up.
Fired up.
Slightly irascible, some might say. Back to you, Wendy, with the Outback Steakhouse halftime report. Welcome back, everyone, to ESPN's College Football Primetime. It's the SEC on ESPN. Number one, Alabama, leading the Kentucky Wildcats at halftime, 24-0. This in spite of the fact that the offense, led by A.J. McCarron, turned the ball over twice early in the first quarter. Much to the chagrin of their head coach, Nick Saban. Alabama going to kick off to begin this third quarter of play. Kentucky playing without its starting quarterback, Jalen Whitlow. We'll have an update from Lewis Johnson in just a moment. But the Crimson Tide looking for their 17th consecutive road win.
And after trending worldwide on Twitter in that first quarter because of a couple early blemishes, as Nick Saban told Lewis going into halftime, it was dominant. It was 22 first downs to 4. It was outgaining Kentucky by over 300 yards and possessing the ball for twice as long. Kentucky just could not get anything going offensively, a meager 60 yards. Let's see here at halftime what kind of adjustments, if any, they can make.
All right, we're going to start off first and 10 from the 25-yard line. Brock, obviously, with number one Alabama, the prohibitive favorite coming into this ball game. Success and progress measured in different ways for Alabama as we move forward in the third quarter.
Well, you like to see them overcoming a little bit of adversity. And for me tonight, most importantly, and when Nick said we want to be a dominant team, I hear physicality. I hear point of attack. And that second quarter, the most yards they've had in any quarter this season, over 200 total yards, and really having their way with an inferior opponent, both in size and strength, and in execution as well tonight, Mark.
First and 10, Maxwell Smith out of the shotgun. Hands it off to Sanders. Nice move by Sanders. And a first down on the first play of the second half for the Wildcats. Sanders, the team's leading rusher a season ago, 669 yards and 5 touchdowns. Sanders again trying the right side again. Got 3. So much has been made, Brock, about that offensive line for Alabama, and saying that, you know, there's 3 new faces from a season ago and they won the national championship. What about the defensive front?
Stout. I mean, just heavy-handed, strong guys, very difficult to move. And while maybe the negative plays and the tackles for loss and the sacks haven't been quite where they've been in years past, I see a group that gets their hands on people and you just simply don't move them.
Smith on 2nd and 7. And brought down behind the line of scrimmage. It's going to be a loss of about 4 on the play. Ed Stinson, 6'4" senior out of Homestead, Florida, getting the sack.
And in 5 games, had just a half a sack, kind of representative of the rest of the team. Through 5 games this year, they had just 6 sacks coming into this evening. They're not a huge pressure team. They're a play very stout, suffocate that pocket, and allow all of the other talent at the second level and in the secondary to run around. Basically, Mark, they just play their assignments very, very sound.
That pass incomplete. Intended for Alexander Montgomery out of Cypress Bay High School in Weston, Florida. And they'll have to punt. 4th down coming up after that good start on first down, where they got the first down run from Sanders. They've got 7 3 and outs tonight. Jones back at his own 23. Alabama came after it a bit. Jones calling for the fair catch all the way back near the 20-yard line. Let's go downstairs to Lou.
All right, Mark, thanks very much. Well, Mark Stoops coming out of the locker room. He's got a lot on his plate. First of all, the news about his quarterback, Jalen Whitlow, who went out early in the first quarter. He has a left ankle injury and is out for the rest of the game. I'm not quite so sure if he's going to be in jeopardy for the next couple of weeks. He's now down on the sideline with a boot, but he is out. He wants to see, Stoops, the Alabama offense get off the field a little bit faster. In other words, he wants his defense to play better as this second half continues. A couple of other quick injury updates. Fred Tiller out with a stinger. Demario Robinson out with an ankle. And Nate Robinson, who had calves cramping, has returned.
All right, and Coach Stoops still trying to build the depth with Kentucky. Hold those losses, and another dropped pass. This one by Kenny Bell. Boy, but that type of night, strange to see, Brock. Alabama receivers drop as many passes and running backs drop as many passes as we've seen tonight. I'm thinking about 3 or 4 that I've seen already.
Yeah, just concentration. It's playing every single snap. It's executing the finer fundamentals and the details. And no matter who your opponent is, what the setting, what the score, That level of execution, so much about what Nick Saban and this program preaches.
Fowler in motion now sets. Yeldon, nice cut, got a nice block. Yeldon on the move, and the big fella into Kentucky territory as we go back to Wendy in a studio.
Thank you, Mark. It's a final, and we have an upset. Stanford among the 17 undefeated teams to enter play today, but they are undefeated no more. Kevin Hogan overthrows here on fourth down, and Utah pulls off the upset 27-21. Mark?
Wow. Okay. So we have one less unbeaten team. 34-yard gain by Yeldon. Upset Saturday continues. McCarron wide open. This one caught by Cooper. And Cooper with a couple of nice moves down to the 3-yard line. And you can hear the throng of Crimson Tide fans that have made the trip saying, "Cool." Amari Cooper with a nice play. 41 yards in all, Brock.
A deep play action pass. The double post clears it out, and this is the deep over concept, and all that heavy run sucks up the linebackers. And Cooper was so good at finding those voids a year ago, doing damage after the catch. As I said, he's one of these weapons that you know you can count on when healthy. And you combine it with the improved run game over the last 3 weeks, Alabama looking more like themselves from a season ago.
Yeldon broke one tackle. Spun away from another. Got in, touchdown. What a play by TJ Yeldon. Great spin move here, put it on spin cycle. And found his way into the end zone for the second time tonight.
That's five tacklers. That's two arm tackles, two others hanging on. As you see some of the quickness, the strength, and the power of TJ Yeldon.
And another Kentucky player down in the field. Yeldon's going now, has gone over 100 yards rushing tonight. 15 rushes, 112 yards, two touchdowns. Bama up 30-0 when we come back. Dante Rump on the sidelines. Helped off the field during the commercial break. Alabama, meanwhile, has scored on five consecutive drives. And an extra point away from leading 31-0. Interesting first half after a turbulent start, Brock, for Alabama. A couple of turnovers. They finally got in rhythm.
Yeah, some uncharacteristic, really, turnovers by both Alabama backs, Drake and Yeldon. But then you see the response. Look at big Ari Quanjo getting out in front. Just get a hat on a hat. If you can do that consistently, communicate, combo block, a nice job there by the center, Lindsey, to get onto the second level, the linebacker. And we talked in the open of this show. The offensive line of last season for A.J. McCarron and crew was one of the best that college football has seen, and I think Notre Dame and Manti Te'o could attest to that a season ago. This group has been a bit of a work in progress, and I think part of the reason that maybe Coach Saban was a little fired up going into break was the notion that, you know, that wasn't as complete and dominant as effort as it was at the point of attack, especially as those 30 minutes emerged. And watch for more of it here in the second half. He's not going to let off the gas when the backups go in. And it can be run, 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 and even further opportunity with the number twos that will push the number ones like Grant Hill to continue to get that pad level, to get to that combo block, to get to the second level. Because if you add that element to this mix with these receivers, these running backs, tough to stop. And this just in, Mark, Alabama pretty balanced too. 225 rushing yards, 226 passing yards.
Yeah, they're on pace, partner, to eclipse 700 yards of total offense in this game.
And I think you're coming off the gas pedal. That's the one thing that Nick Saban is you're going to see, I think, a lot of backups here pretty soon.
Let's go to our first stringer in the studio. Not a backup, Wendy Nix.
Mark, thank you very much. What a game. Michigan, Penn State, again, Michigan undefeated, but they too fall. How about this? Bill Belton on the carry, rushes left into the end zone in quadruple overtime. They are going absolutely crazy in Happy Valley, and with good reason. And how about Bill O'Brien, uncharacteristically fired up after a huge win for his Penn State program. Again, the final in quadruple overtime. Texas A&M leading Ole Miss 14-7 on ESPN. Johnny Manziel injured, was helped off the field, but he has returned with a knee brace.
All right, Wendy, back here. Sanders on the run, nice gain of about eight. And boy, what a surprising Saturday it has been with some of the upsets. And you have to feel great for Coach O'Brien at Penn State when you look at the litany of issues that he's had to deal with since coming aboard. Texas upsetting Oklahoma in that Red River rivalry. And do you think that saves
Brown for a little bit? Holy smokes.
Right. Buys him a little bit of time, you'd think.
Did they play hard today? Missouri, no backing down, undefeated. Utah, I knew going into that game, as beat up as Stanford was, would give them every challenge and test, and ultimately a huge win for Kyle Whittingham and his program.
Sanders gets the first down on a gain of about 4 yards. And, you know, you can discount Missouri's win if you want to, because Georgia was shorthanded, missing some key elements, especially offensively. But Missouri is not a surprise anymore. They've got some talent on that team.
And I think a pretty good debate as to whose win there was it most important for the head coach. Now, obviously, for job security and the heat that has been so hot down in Austin. But for Gary Pinkel, made some staff changes. For Kyle Whittingham, trying to find his place and standing in the Pac-12. And for Bill O'Brien, as you mentioned, just underneath the challenges and adversity that his program faces.
Pass low but caught right at midfield. Great grab by Blue. Davis Blue, a 6-foot junior with a nice scoop here. 14-yard gain. He caught that.
Pass midfield.
First and 10. And the pocket just collapsed. Robinson with the sack for Alabama. And a flag thrown. Robinson, one of those talented freshmen defensively for Alabama that Coach Saban is really enamored with.
After the play is over, personal foul. 93, defense, 15-yard penalty, automatic, first down.
That's Jonathan Allen.
That's another true freshman right at the top of your screen here. He's mixing it up. He doesn't like getting driven into the ground by Zach West. And
after the whistle.
There you go.
First and 10. From the 41, the Wildcats looking for their first points. Sanders, and Raymond Sanders gains about four.
Well, you know, you got the same sense that I did, Mark, yesterday about A'shaun Robinson, the big defensive end, defensive tackle. When you talk about reloading and developing, it's sure nice to do it with a 6'4", 310-pound athlete. Those are the five-star kids that when you lose the Terrence Codys and the Hightowers and the McLeans and the first rounders and nine draft picks from a season ago, well, those are the kind of freshmen that get their opportunities and chances in games like this, second halves like these.
And Sanders here
to show what they can do.
Stopped up by one of those potential NFL first rounders, C.J. Mosley, making the stop along with Robinson that time. Conversely, when you're building and in the process of strengthening your program like Mark Stoops is right now, Talked to him about his blueprint. He said one of the first things he had to do was solidify his recruiting, making phone calls to recruits and establishing that recruiting base. The strength and conditioning of the high performance program was also a very high priority issue with him. Here's the Wildcat formation, and JoJo Kemp might have gotten a yard. And fourth down coming up. Stopped by C.J. Mosley again. And then the last thing that Coach Stoops talked about, besides the recruiting and the high-performance strength conditioning program, was the amount of great buy-in that he got from the players that were already here. It wasn't a situation where there was a lot of disgruntled people and players who, you know, decided to leave or weren't on the same page with the head coach, the new head coach. Fourth and two, and that's a good sign if you're looking to build at Kentucky. They get the first down. Raymond Sanders with the run. Let's go downstairs to Lewis for more.
Well, Mark, to continue that thought, remember we talked to Mark Stoops about that formula for the turnaround here at UK, and he said being in Arizona for 6 years as defensive coordinator really helped him out to prepare for this head coaching opportunity at Kentucky. Yeah, he feels some frustration at times, but he knows that he has to stay patient, and that's the word, patience, that was a common thread, the advice from his two brothers, Bob and Mike Stoops, both coaching at Oklahoma. Patience.
Great point, Lou. Pass complete. Blue, touchdown, Kentucky. It's the first touchdown that Alabama's defense has given up in three-plus games, three-and-a-half games. It's his second touchdown catch of the season. Baby steps. Plays like this give you a little bit of hope. Back with more after this.
ESPN College Football Primetime. Brought to you by Audi, Truth in Engineering, and the Land's End No Iron Dress Shirt, made to work, starting at just $49.
Wow, they're good. The UK squad has won the UCA's National College Cheerleading Championship an unprecedented 19 times. Wow, more than any other Division I-A school, UK squad is the only team to win back-to-back championships three times. A little something to cheer about on that touchdown catch a moment ago.
Yeah, that's what you call a rubber out on offense. Maybe a little pick route to some of those defensive guys, but a nice job by Javis Blue finally getting loose. And that's what they just unfortunately needed earlier. Exactly what Neil Brown said to us yesterday. We've got to get some chunk plays, some one-on-one opportunities. And Blue makes Williams and Fulton run into each other, gets a touchdown. Gives those cheerleaders something to cheer about.
Jones gonna take it out. And Jones brought down beyond the 25 at the 27. Hey, get your NFL Sunday started on ESPN at 10. Sunday NFL Countdown. Chris Berman and the crew getting you up to speed. And then before you set your lineups, catch Fantasy Football Now at 11 a.m. on ESPN2 as our experts provide the latest news, injury reports, and predict the top fantasy performers. The 27-yard line, first down and 10 for Alabama. Adrian McCarron, a lot of work this past summer at the Manning camp, refining the nuances of his passing game. He also has someone that he works with back home in Mobile, Alabama. Drake in the backfield. It's Drake with the catch. Check that. That's Jones. And Jones out of bounds has about seven or eight. on first down. Well, they really like to move him around and use him in so many different ways.
Yeah, he's tremendous. Punt returner, kick returner, one of the best in the SEC. Does a nice job out of the slot. I'll tell you one other thing. Look at AJ's uniform tonight. He had a couple scrambles. But this offensive line has not only run blocked really, really well over the last 30 minutes of play, they have also given AJ just tremendous pass protection. He's taken some hits this year on game tape, a little bit more than you're used to seeing him, but not tonight.
First down.
Carrying the ball.
Pascal making the stop. Yeah, he's McCarron's uniform, surprisingly, a little bit dirty. Brock, as a former quarterback, I figured you would notice that.
Well, like I said, I think those were from.
Yeah, look at grass stains. Come on.
Those were from a couple scrambles.
Oh, geez. How's that going to happen?
Well, I'll tell you what else stands out with AJ is when he came to Alabama, you know, he told me preseason he was about 175, 180 pounds. And he's 220 now. He came in, he couldn't squat 185, and he's squatting over 500 pounds. When I talk about development, no matter who you are and how talented you are when you come in, you're going to leave this program better than when you came in.
They take a shot at down deep. And caught by White. DeAndrew White with another circus catch. But there's a flag down all the way back at the 40-yard line, so hold on.
Holding 78 offense 10 yard penalty first down.
It's against the center Chad Lindsey.
Yep, that's going to be a hold on Smith, and that all starts with just that initial target. When you hear not target as in the penalty, but target your block and your head position in your hands. And Smith gets that shoulder pad early, draws that holding call. Not called Smith's name much. He's their leading sacker. But at least he's able to draw the penalty there.
Wipes out a 40-yard gain. Out of the shotgun again. Karen completes it to Cooper. And Amari Cooper gets some of that yardage back out of the 47-yard line. 12-yard gain. Karen, the fifth-year senior, came into the contest tonight completing just under 72% of his passes on the season. Look at the success of this Alabama program over the last 4 years. It really is remarkable what Nick Saban has done. Second down and 8. Jones, nice open field tackle at the 49-yard line by Cody Quinn, and a 4-yard gain on the play.
Okay, so what stood out the most to you? You get a chance to sit down with Nick Saban yesterday and visit the hotel, good 40 minutes with him. All the great coaches you have been around, Jones, in the different sports, what stood out to you in that sit down?
I think it's his ability to compartmentalize things and reduce success in the big picture to segments, and it's what he calls the process. At times it might sound a little bit trite or like a cliche, but it's what they do, and they do it well. 3rd and 3 underneath, complete to White, got the first down and then some. Chopped down finally inside the 20-yard line, and another Alabama first down.
Starts with the protection, a better job against the blitz. You've got man-to-man coverage, the great conundrum that unfortunately DJ Elliott, defensive coordinator Mark Stoops, are in tonight. You know you can't just bring 4. You're not getting home. You try to bring a couple extra. Alabama picks it up, and their athletes, unfortunately, right now for Kentucky, are just faster than yours.
30-yard gain. Down to the 18. Carry it into the end zone. Incomplete intended for O.J. Howard, the tight end. Looked like he may have looked over the wrong shoulder at first. 2nd and 10 coming up. 31-7. And you know, with a 24-point margin, Brock, 3:22 to go, there'd be some that would start wondering, why are most of the ones still in there? Well, this team is still a work in progress. It has some things to get right, correct?
Yep.
Let's go!
Broadway to Drake. And he slipped and fell, or else that could potentially have been a first down. Talk about some things they have to rectify. Here's a look at some. Drops. More than a few. Many for a head coach to mention.
Yeah, 70% passer, as you alluded to on the season. The percentage not there tonight, but there have been clearly five catch and run passes. Just making that final fundamental move to look that ball in, been the difference.
A little motion and now sets on third and six. They're 7-9 on third downs tonight. McCarron underneath, complete. Drake with the catch and the first down. First and goal from about the five for Alabama. And the beat goes on for the Crimson Tide. A 9-yard gain setting up first and goal.
You know, as this season pushes ahead, and well, you do what everybody does with Alabama, everybody always fast forwards just to LSU, but there's Arkansas and Tennessee before then. But this is the quality of work. It is the pass protection. It is getting your backs out. All of those things that you know aren't just about this game tonight. It's always pressing ahead in that process to the big matchups down the road.
First and 10, McCarron. Great ball handling. And incomplete. Intended for Howard. And broken up nicely at the last minute by Nate Willis. Looked like he got a hand in there and ripped it loose.
Yep. Just a tad late. Good effort. Nice to see Kentucky offensively on that previous possession. Put a touchdown together. And I know it's not cliche for these coaches to say, hey, this is your pride. This is your work. This is your body of work. We're watching every single one of these snaps, and you want effort from beginning to end.
10th play of the Alabama drive. Run it in the boundary, Drake brought down on a nice tackle up front. So Kentucky, the big fella Rump, who was shaken up on the last series, back in the ball game, doing a nice job there with under 2 minutes to go in the third quarter.
Yeah, and Uncle Chris is the defensive line coach for Alabama. It's not only for the redshirt senior Rump at Kentucky, is he playing for the back name on his jersey here at Kentucky, but he's trying to show off for Uncle. Up in the booth as well, the D-line coach for the Crimson Tide.
Third and goal. McCarron on the slant, incomplete. Broken up by Cody Quinn, and it's fourth down. Mark Stoops' defense does a nice job on that sequence.
Well, the touchdown pass eluded the Crimson Tide. A couple of them have been dropped. We saw one just a little bit late to the tight end. The free blitzer comes in. Man, that's one that DeAndre would like the penalty. AJ probably like to throw a foot in front. And DeAndre would also like to find a way to bring that in.
Made that circus catch that we showed a little bit earlier last week against Georgia State. Foster in the ballgame now. Connected earlier from 25. This one coming from 20. And he drills it through. Alabama rolling it along. Back with more after this.
Live in Lexington, and time for a look at the FaceTime profile brought to you by Edward Jones. Well, it was back in May when three Kentucky seniors made the trip to Ethiopia, part of an athletic department service trip. Jonathan George, Avery Williamson, And Kevin Mitchell there for a week visiting families, distributing food, handing out filters to those without clean water, even helping to put up some tarps over some homes, getting prepared for the rainy season. All three of those guys, Mark, were very humbled by their experience, returned to Lexington thankful and appreciative for what they have. Jonathan George says he hopes to go back. Kentucky actually sends two groups a year to Ethiopia. One is a football group, and the other group comprised of athletes from other sports, but obviously doing great work and affecting these young people when they make a trip out of the country like that.
Yeah, great experience for them, Lou, whenever they travel overseas and carry out magnanimous gestures like that. It's going to change your perspective for a long time on things. Alabama leading 34-7. Number two, Blue. It's Blue that had the touchdown catch a moment ago and a nice kickoff return out to the 32-yard line. Well, the most storied conference in college athletics will live on a new network. Tradition has found a new home. The SEC Network launching August 2014. For more information, log on to www.getsecnetwork.com. A lot of games and all your favorite sports. SEC Network on ESPN. Part of the great tradition of the conference.
Starters still in. I don't think you want to leave with the sour taste of a touchdown drive. I think you'd love nothing more than to get your starters one more series, get a three and out. Continue to do what you've done largely all night long, play very sound and dominating defense.
There's JoJo Kent trying to get to the edge and couldn't quite square those shoulders and turn it up. Gain of about three on the play. C.J. Mosley making the stop. You know, C.J. Mosley, one of those players that is a leader for this team, especially on defense. You know, it was in the wake of that disappointing Colorado State game that he led kind of a players only get together and spoke his mind in the locker room in the wake of that game. It's a little bit of a tipping point for the improved performance that Coach Saban noted coming into the game tonight in our meetings with him. As Raymond Sanders getting to the outside and ends up about a yard short of the first down. 16 seconds to go in the third quarter, and Sanders comes up limping a little bit. Holding that left leg. Boy, it has been a night of attrition for the Wildcats. They lost their starting quarterback, Jalen Whitlow, on their second offensive series. Other guys nicked and bruised up as well. They'll limp into the fourth quarter with Mosley and the Alabama defense on the field. And the Crimson Tide leading 34-7 when we come back to Lexington. You can kind of chill on the bench.
Visit WatchESPN.com or download the Watch ESPN app to watch ESPN live anytime, anywhere. Brought to you by Vizio.
Back for the start of the fourth quarter. They're flipping out, but for Alabama right now, the Crimson Tide going to the final 15 minutes with a 34-7 lead, looking to improve to a perfect 6-0 in the season and 3-0 in SEC play. Kentucky still in search of its first conference win this year. Third down and one. JoJo Kemp in motion. They hand it off to Jonathan George. It's going to be close. Looks like he got it. Jonathan George with his first carry of the ball game, a 5'10 senior from Lincoln, Alabama. Shotgun, play fake, Smith with time. And now that pocket collapses and sacks him back at the 37-yard line. Robinson was the first one there. You know, Brock, you were talking to me earlier about what is the most impressive quality of Coach Saban. He told his players a story about a 2x4, and he said, guys, I want you to walk across this piece of wood, this 2x4, and they could do it easily. The purpose is to focus. He said, if I put that 2x4 40 stories up between two buildings, you guys are going to think differently about this task, but you shouldn't. You shouldn't be thinking about the failure of falling. You should be thinking about the success of just walking across that board. That, in a nutshell, great exercise in focusing on what you can do and potential success versus pitfalls.
Well, I'll tell you the thing that I've probably grown to appreciate about Nick Saban more than anything else. There's a lot of really good X's and O's coaches out there. And even though he loves the chess match and feels like maybe some of these tempo offenses don't allow him to play the chess the way he wants to do it, he's the motivator. And we saw it earlier. We saw it in the second quarter today where he calls a timeout to do what? To get right in the ear of his true freshman right tackle, to push the buttons and to motivate. And to me, to take the amount of talent that he has that walks in the door, and the number of stars, and in this day and age, the level of entitlement that many of them bring to the table, and to just cut that stuff out and get them to work, and as you said in that story, to get them to focus and buy in.
Delay of game. Offense, number 11, 5-yard penalty, third down.
I think I can say unequivocally, there's nobody in college football that does that better.
Tell you what, he had a little help from our Herm Edwards earlier this year. Went and spoke to the Alabama football team, and the Rev had it going there. And I don't know if you saw that SportsCenter piece, but Coach Edwards had his coaching hat back on, did a nice job there. Third and 21. Maxwell Smith underneath, complete to Jonathan George. And George brought down at the 44-yard line. Picked up 11.
My guess who? That's my guy, C.J. Mosley. And, man, was it fun to talk defensive football with Nick yesterday about what makes that guy so special. I look forward to chatting with Tom McShay later as well, just about when you hear instinct, and that word gets thrown around, oh, this guy has great instinct, this guy can do that. Well, what is instinct? Is instinct just tremendous athleticism? Is instinct knowing your game plan inside and out? Is instinct having tremendous speed and explosiveness so you can finish? I mean, what is instinct? The great ones have it. He's got it in spades. Going to be a terrific NFL player because of it.
Good directional punt that time by Landon Foster. And Alabama knows about sending players into the NFL. We'll talk to our draft expert, Todd McShay, when we come back on the other side. Under the lights at Commonwealth Stadium, Alabama leading Kentucky 34-7. With 11:54 to go in the fourth quarter, Alabama on the verge of its 17th consecutive road win and its 10th straight overall dating back to last year. A.J. McCarron has gone the distance at quarterback. Once again, it's all about efficiency, this time handing it off to Yeldon. And right now we're going to bring in Todd McShay back from the studio. And Todd, let's talk about the draft prospects of A.J. McCarron. Where do you see him potentially going? Is he a first-round pick?
You know, I don't know if he's going to be in the first round, Mark, but I do think when we get into day two, he fits in there. You've got a lot of second-round, third-round quarterbacks in this year's class. When I look at his skill set, he has the size, 6'3", he's getting bulked up. He has the accuracy, short to intermediate, good touch. Obviously, he knows how to protect the football. He's 59 touchdowns compared to just the 10 interceptions, and he's a winner. And when you look at it, 30-2 as a starter, but can he drive the ball vertically, and can he make all the throws down the field? I think that's one of the, you know, the big areas when you start to look at him in the next level. A lot of competition, as I said, at quarterback this year. Teddy Bridgewater from Louisville, Brett Hundley from UCLA, Marcus Mariota from Oregon if he comes out, Johnny Manziel from Texas A&M, and now guys like Zach Mettenberger from LSU are starting to emerge as well.
You talk about that arm talent, Todd. Can he push it downfield? Because even tonight, we've seen a couple of examples of that, and I'm not seeing that wow moment, that game tape that Teddy can have and Taj can have and Marcus can have. Does he have elite enough arm strength down the field to be a starter in the game?
Well, Brock, you know as well as anyone, and I talk to you all the time about these draft quarterbacks. Arm strength can be overrated at certain times, but I think you have to have a certain baseline, and you've got to be able to make those throws. And, you know, even you said it earlier in this broadcast, I thought you put it very well. The timing was there. He got the ball out right when he should have, but it just sailed in the air a little bit too long, and he's forcing his receivers to go up and make a play on the ball. So it's just one aspect of his game, but I think when you start to talk about you know, the Andrew Lux and the RG3s and the special qualities that they have, and then you start to talk about second-tier quarterbacks, I think you probably get into maybe the third tier with when you talk about A.J. McCarron, just simply because he doesn't have that exceptional skill set with the arm strength. And while he's deceptively mobile, I don't think he has elite mobility, obviously.
He just connected on another touchdown, another record-setting number for McCarron. And a touchdown, Alabama. Todd, we're going to pick it up with you in just a short minute. But we're going to wait for the extra point as Alabama makes it 40-7 on his 11th touchdown catch, pardon me, pass this season. That's the 60th of his career. Todd, we're going to have you stick around and get back to you on the other side of this.
We talk a little defense, not just quarterbacks, more than quarterbacks in the draft.
Yeah, we're going to talk about C.J. Mosley when we come back. Alabama cruising.
College Football Primetime, brought to you by Subway. Try the Tuscan Chicken Melt $6 foot-long special today. And Mazda, we believe if it's not worth driving, it's not worth building.
Welcome back, everyone, to Lexington, Kentucky. It's the SEC on ESPN. Alabama well on the way to their sixth win of the season. And C.J. Mosley about to take the field on defense as the Crimson Tide gets set to kick off. Talk about the guy that is a difference maker on the field for one of the top defenses in the country.
More than 500 tackles in high school.
Wow. Out of Theodore, Alabama. 6'3", 238. Senior, one of the leaders. Maybe the alpha dog on defense. 2 yard line. Mobley on the kickoff return, all the way out to the beyond the 25.
You know, every once in a while, I will cut out that maybe from you. Okay. Maybe the alpha dog. The guy right in the middle is the alpha dog. And if this play does not epitomize C.J. Mosley, then I don't know football. Look at him bark at his guys. He knows exactly what's coming. He studied his game tape. He knows that the Wildcat quarterback sweep is going that way. And look at him. You said alpha dog still barking at his guys to listen.
Yeah.
That happens with instincts, but instincts are largely born out of all that work and preparation.
Quiet by nature, but one of those players, when he speaks, his teammates listen. We're going to bring Todd McShay back in here and ask him about... Hey, Todd, you there?
I'm here.
Tell me about C.J. Mosley and what are his skill sets and where do you see him going in the NFL draft?
And you guys were talking about the alpha dog. I remember last year, Nick Saban, the beginning of the year, he's saying we really need an alpha dog to step up at this linebacker position or on our defense, period. And you saw him kind of develop into that player throughout the course of last year. And when I went back and studied the tape this offseason, I thought he was the best defensive prospect at any position on the defensive side that I watched. Now, he's got some injuries. He's got to continue to get a little bit stronger. But I think he's improved his take-on skills in terms of dealing with blockers on the second level. And you talk about instincts. I mean, he has rare instincts. There's preparation. A lot of guys do preparation. Then there's transferring the preparation to the field. And that's just part having great football instincts and also just knowing how to find those adjustments in game and make split-second decisions. He can rush the quarterback. He can drop in coverage. He's a sideline-to-sideline defender, and he gets guys lined up in the right place. He may not be a top 10 pick because of the position, but he should be somewhere in the top 20 picks, and it won't surprise me if he's in the first half of the first round if he goes out for this year's April or May's draft now. They move him to May 8th.
Personal foul. Pass me the face mask. 95 on defense. 15-yard penalty. First down.
You know, as you know better than anybody, it's all about projecting, Todd. And CJ's different than some of the guys that have come out in this draft. He's different than a McLean or a Hightower. His skill set, can't you argue that his skill set projects better to what the NFL game is today, a passing game and in space, maybe better than some of his previous peers?
Absolutely, Brock. I mean, that's exactly it, too, because while you have to be able to stop the run and defend the run, you've got to be able to line up and nickel and dime and cover guys and the versatility that he brings. I think he's their best pass rusher. And really, that's not what he's built to do. But they can line him up at defensive end if they want at times as a rush linebacker on the outside. Great instincts rushing up the middle, finding that A gap or the B gap. I think that he is perfectly suited for today's NFL.
All right, Todd, thanks a lot for joining us, buddy, and look forward to more commentary from you in the studio.
Say hi to Robert for us, too, if you will.
Next time, I'll make sure Robert Smith doesn't photobomb us.
That was one of the best. Coming back from the cafeteria, no doubt. Thanks, guys.
Take care, man.
Side heat. And they just hit Maxwell Smith as he released it. Patrick there to get him on the backside.
You see Kentucky, look at that, synchronized up front. Two or three times we have seen this tonight. Usually it's just those tackles traditionally that will try to chop block. Kentucky does it with all five. But there's the level of athleticism of that defensive line. They just hop right over those cut blocks. And Mr. Smith, like many of these Wildcats, going to be sore tomorrow morning.
Third down and six for Kentucky. 2:09 to go. Incomplete, intended for Ryan Timmons. Should have made the catch, but that ball was right on top of him as he got his head around, and it's fourth down coming up. Timmons, a pretty talented player, too. Won the Kentucky State High School Sprint Championship in the 100 meters as a sophomore, as a junior, and as a senior. I mean, that is fast in a state that produced some pretty fast people, especially here in Lexington, Kentucky. The American world record holder in the 100 meters from Lexington, Kentucky, Tyson Gay. You know I'm tight with the track community, bro.
Yeah, you better be careful. We're going to go down to Lewis and finish up this show talking track.
Dee Hart back with his punt. They're going to blow this one dead. But we talked about it a little bit before. All kidding aside, Ryan Timmons, part of some talented players coming in now for Mark Stoops, their recruiting class.
Illegal substitution on the defense, 5 yards, fourth down.
Nick Saban putting some more of his players on blast there. But, yeah, some talented people coming in for Mark Stoops, their recruiting class, ranked number 16.
And it's what they're going to have to do. You've added a couple junior college kids. We saw Blue with the touchdown earlier. And he's a difference maker. You see the defensive end on the other side. Darius Smith, the guy that's made the most plays tonight. He was the number two ranked defensive end from the junior college ranks. Number 16 right now. I mean, that's a stratosphere they have not been in as far as their recruiting class current rank. He's going to have to put and pile a bunch of those classes together here.
Tell you what, they snapped that ball before the official even got a chance to get out of there. And it was Smith keeping it on fourth and short. I'm not sure that he got it. Let's take a look at the spot. On fourth and short.
Yeah, I don't think he got anywhere near it, Mark.
The body's clear where they put this. Oh, no, he's going to be short. Still going to measure. That's going to be Alabama football. When you go up against the number one team in the nation and one of the top defenses in the nation, there are going to be some long days as a quarterback. And not only will it be a long day for your quarterback, for your offensive coordinator like Neil Brown, Excedrin headache number 42. Pass the bottle. With in-depth analysis, discussion of the standings, potential impact of upcoming games, and interviews with college football coaches and players, you'll want to go anywhere else. BCS Countdown, presented by Allstate, next Sunday at 8:30 on ESPN, and then at 9 on ESPNU. Both shows also live on the Watch ESPN app. Blake Sims in now at quarterback for Alabama. And Sims hands it off to Alti Tempe. Let's look at Oregon's schedule. Oregon defeating Washington today. What do you make of the style points that Oregon might have picked up today?
Well, what I make is a little bit like Alabama, Mark. It's going to come down to a couple week stretch here. That game with UCLA, UCLA will play on our air, just following us at Stanford. Stanford doesn't have the depth that Oregon has, and Stanford was a wounded, beat-up team coming out of that Washington game. And I think that showed at Utah today as they go down. But Oregon, to me, there's a few challengers to this Crimson Tide team. Oregon is at the top of that list. Clemson, Florida State, who play against each other, they're probably next in that pecking order.
Tenpenny on another run. How much does Stanford's loss hurt Oregon in terms of, opponent?
Well, I think in years past, to be honest with you, Mark, it would have hurt more. I think people know, voters know, those computers know that Oregon and what they have established and what they built, and now with a Heisman contending quarterback, I don't think you're going to see a shortage of any level of respect.
And Penny again, close to the first down and falls forward to get it.
Does that make sense? I know what you're saying as far as the computers and the strength of the Pac-12 conference. And I think that will come out in the computers next Sunday. UCLA is right near a top 10 team. Oregon and Stanford in that top 10. Washington at number 15, 16. And then really the strength top to bottom. You know, Danny Cannell last night on the Friday night broadcast, you know, he started getting into good conversation about the SEC West and the Pac-12 North. And obviously the Stanford loss.
Great matchups,
There'd be some great matchups. But, I mean, I think those are legitimately, I think anybody with some reasonable sense here would argue that those are the two best divisions in football. And there would be some tremendous matchups on the neutral field between them.
I think SEC fans would tell you the two best divisions, though, are the SEC East and the SEC West. we're gonna catch a little bit of heat for that in SEC country. It's all good.
Yep.
All part of some healthy debate.
Yeah, but I think you saw today, Georgia is a beat-up team. Yeah. Florida's a one-dimensional team, play tremendous defense, but they're not where you need to be explosive-wise. Now, South Carolina is very dangerous, and they've got a couple underrated. Everyone talks Clowney. Oh, boy, they've got some underrated pieces, especially offensively, as they just rolled Arkansas today.
Arkansas taking it on the chin a couple weeks in a row, last week in Florida. At homecoming today against South Carolina. But it's incredible when you think about the divide that exists between people in SEC country and particularly the SEC West. When you start talking about potential challengers to Alabama and to LSU, there's a perception out there that the Pac-12, you know, Oregon and the likes, can't play with them, especially because they don't play defense. That's the popular chorus and refrain you hear. How do you debate that? We'll see after this play. We'll talk about that after this play. Tim's hands it off. And Sims hands it off to Henry. Nice run inside the 30. Your thoughts on that perception?
Well, I would say last year, perception and reality were a lot closer in that way. Mm-hmm. LSU puts eight guys in the league defensively. Georgia puts how many? Just about that many. Alabama, nine guys drafted a year ago. There has been some talent drain on this league. Now, they are the seven-time heavyweight champ.
Right.
They deserve their respect. Until you unseat the champ, you give them all the respect in the world. But to just pass off the Pac-12 and UCLA and Oregon, Washington, Stanford, and not think that they're quality teams, or think that an Oregon on a neutral field couldn't play with any of those teams that push them to the brink, no. Oregon is really, really good. And I'll say this lastly, Mark. I think Ohio State was better a year ago.
Than this year, really?
Yeah. I think that Ohio State team was better last year. I think this Alabama team is a work in progress, and I take that offensive line and that team from a year ago. I think an LSU was so much better defensively. The only teams, I'd say Clemson and Oregon, are better this year than they were last year. And then Florida State's in a tremendous enigma because you lose how many NFL guys and a first-round NFL quarterback, and you may be better than you were a year ago. So Nick Saban knows.
You think this thing is pretty wide open still?
Well, I think that there's a clear divide between those top four or five and obviously everybody else.
Pass complete.
And if you didn't watch...
Tim's coming in.
And if you didn't watch Marcus Mariota today, and you didn't see what he did in that venue, And I'll show you the little text exchange with some former NFL guys that all said the same thing.
I'm a believer. That
kid is just different. I felt that, Mark, preseason going up there and watching them in preseason practice, taking a tour of that facility. Everyone wondered about Chip Kelly in the void and could he replace it. Well, that guy has filled all that void up and more. He is a bona fide Heisman contender who deserves the respect.
Sims went airborne and got rocked. Short of the first down. 4:22 to go in the ball game. Eric Dixon making the hit from his free safety spot for the Kentucky Wildcats.
And when you have that pivot man at that position in that offense, you've seen it. Cam Newton did what?
Yeah.
From that position in that system and offense, took games over, carried a team. I do think Mariota is that special.
You know, you talk about potential matchups between the best of the Pac-12 and the best of the SEC. You think about, you know, Cam Newton, Auburn that year, Oregon. That was a much closer game than a lot of people thought. A lot of people didn't think that Oregon could play defense against Auburn. Maybe a much closer game than a lot of people thought. That's Hart on the run. Under 4 minutes to go in the ball game. Alabama can improve to 6-0.
And then to dismiss, since we're just on this rant and conversation or whatever you'd like to define it. The ACC, and people will say, oh, Clemson, Florida State, look at the ACC over the years. Those two are better than they have been. And that is must-see TV next week. I can't wait to watch Taj Boyd, Jameis Winston go at it. Clemson in the ultimate trap game survived today and weathered three very ugly quarters. But that's going to be some tremendous football.
Clemson might have hit the snooze bar a little bit early in that game against Boston College as Hart takes it forward as we go back to the studio and Wendy.
Mark, thank you. A Dr. Pepper 10 conference update. Texas A&M and Ole Miss. A very un-Johnny Manziel-like first half, but this is Trey Williams doing his part. Takes it in from 17 yards. Manziel, 12 of 15, 98 yards, and no touchdowns, but the Aggies with a touchdown lead. Coming up, Brett Hundley, the sophomore, has the seventh most career passing yards in UCLA history, just behind Troy Aikman. His team set to take on Cal, coming up, bottom of the hour.
All right, Wendy, back here. Another running play, Tenpenny. Well, we talked about that game coming up, Florida State and Clemson. A couple of talented quarterbacks pulling the trigger at their respective positions for the respective teams. Look at that touchdown to interception ratio. And it was interesting when we spoke with Mark Stoops, who was at Florida State last year. He said, you know, I knew Winston was good. I'm not sure he was. I didn't know he was that good.
Yeah. He said we had some fun with him. And he'd poke fun at him and scream at him and yell at him as he's running some of the scout stuff against his defense. And for certain quarterbacks, you can just watch and you know they've got that it factor. He's one of them.
Tenpenny with the touchdown. And the beat goes on for Alabama. A look of resignation for head coach Mark Stoops. And he's not the only one. A lot of coaches that have felt that way against Alabama this year. A lot of Alabama fans already thinking about that Alabama-LSU game down the road a few weeks. A prohibited favorite coming in.
Penalty markers are down.
False start, 64 offense, 5-yard penalty, retry.
They keep sending up Coach Saban's pressure.
He's a guy with a famous name again, that right tackle Grant Hill.
Extra point good. I just hope Coach Saban doesn't put the youngster on blast again. He's running right into it. Welcome back, everyone, to College Football Primetime. Alabama leading 48-7 here at Commonwealth Stadium, and Alabama is going to have its 17th consecutive road win. and their 10th win in a row dating back to last year. I'm Mark Jones along with Brock Heward, chopping it up with Lewis Johnson down in the sidelines as well. As the Tide continue to roll, getting more record-setting touchdown passes from its quarterback tonight, A.J. McCarron, who has taken the rest of the night off. 21-35 for 359 yards and a touchdown pass, a career-high 35 attempts, a career-high 359 yards. Not a bad game manager. Tongue-in-cheek, of course, folks. This one will come back out to the 25-yard line. We'll take a break and come back on the other side. Welcome back. After that last Alabama extra point, it cleared the net. This fan got the ball, and look what he does.
Enough.
You're supposed to throw it back on the field, aren't you? A little differently here in Kentucky, in Lexington. To seven, and next week Alabama has Arkansas up on the schedule, a struggling Arkansas Razorback team. Brett Bielema's team taking one on the chin today at home against South Carolina. Approaching a minute to go. JoJo Kemp. And Kemp gains about 2 yards. Some final thoughts on, albeit a rough start, a pretty good finish for Alabama. Probably.
All about the process, as you said, and you wondered if Alabama could play a complete game. Was this their best game? Now, it's hard to judge against an opponent that's in rebuild mode. But that second quarter, A.J. and crew said, enough's enough. And when you can establish that run, you play the defense that they do, going to be very difficult to find an L in their regular season, Mark.
Think back to that game as Kentucky wins again. Think back to that Texas A&M game when the Aggies were miraculously able to put 42 points up against that defense. That seems like a long time ago.
Sure
now.
Does.
Now, the way that this defense has played the last several games. And it might say more about Texas A&M offensively than it does about Alabama
yep,
defensively.
CJ and crew are pretty good, Jonesy.
Nick Saban and Kentucky win it 48-7. Coming up next, stick around, folks. Pac-12 action. Cal taking on UCLA. For Lewis Johnson, Brock Heward, I'm Mark Jones, and a talented crew behind the camera you never get a chance to see. Good night from Lexington, Kentucky.